I wrestling in my doubts, in my failures you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea, oh. You are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining through the darkness, I will follow you. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. Safe to shore. I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea, oh. You are the peace in my troubled sea. You are my lighthouse, my lighthouse. Shine through the darkness, I will follow you. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Together, so let us join in worship. We worship to keep our souls awake, to keep learning and growing and giving back to the world. We worship in community as a reminder that we are not alone. We worship when we show up and bless a moment in the lives of one another, a birth, a death, a transition into the next chapter of life. We worship in giving thanks for the gift that is life. And so let us celebrate this life through song now with our opening hymn. We join together in hymn number 12, O Life That Maketh All Things New. Number 12 in your gray hymnal. Please rise as you're able.
Thank you.
Please remain standing if you are, and join together in saying the affirmation of our church, followed by the doxology. You can find the words to these printed inside your order of service. Love is the doctrine of our church. The quest of truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve humanity in fellowship, to the end that all souls shall grow in harmony with the divine. Thus do we covenant with each other. Everyone, welcome to church. The first hymn talks about from hand to hand the greeting flows. So let's greet one another in the pews and welcome each other to church.
Can I please see the hands of children who are gonna go to a Sunday school class later? Yeah, I definitely see your hands. You're doing a super good job at that. Anybody else? I'm telling you, you cannot see the example of how skillfully they're doing this. Yeah, there's another one, okay. Aha, good. See, now I know where you are. This is helpful. Reverend Dana, there's a lot of people sitting in the front few pews. That's unusual. Yeah, but a lot of them look, yeah, a lot of them are teenagers. There's a lot of teenagers sitting in the front at church. I'm going to guess they did it voluntarily because they just love being here. Yeah, that's exactly right. There's also another possibility which does not preclude the other option, which is that today is the day when we are going to bless and recognize teenagers in our church who are either growing up and maybe some of them leaving home or finding a job or graduating from high school or maybe even leaving the church to go somewhere, and others who are becoming adults in our church and coming of age. So can I see the hands again of the people who raised their hands last time? Okay, some of you have not opted in a second time, okay. Yeah. So what we're gonna do is bless them. And sometimes a blessing, some people might think that a blessing means making something precious or good or holy. And other people think that a blessing is saying out loud that something is already precious and good and holy. And that's the kind of blessing that we're gonna do today. We're gonna look at these young people, these young adults who've grown up in our congregation and look at them and say, we're so glad you're here. But we're also glad that all of you are here. You are precious and good and holy just as you are, and our church wouldn't be the same without you. So each week when we bless you and sing you to your classes, that's one of our ways of saying we love you. We just do it with a song. And so let's do that together. If you will, join me in singing our children and their Sunday school teachers to class. The words to the song, Go Now in Peace, are printed in your order of service.
Go now in peace.
Good morning and welcome to First Unitarian Church of Dallas. We're a progressive center of religion right here in Dallas since 1899. If you're looking to find out a little bit more about who we are, you should know that we affirm that people encounter what we call God in many ways, that all people are worthy of love and justice without exception, and that religion for us isn't about what happens after you die, but rather how we create a more loving and just world right here and right now. If you want to find out more about where the bathrooms are or what we teach children, what it means to join the church or why we worship the way we do, the Inquirer's class is a great option for you. I want to invite you to that. It happens every week at 11:30 during this hour in the parlor just on this side of the sanctuary. Also, if you're interested in jumping in to ask questions about the church and learn more, I'm going to be leading a class on the 22nd that's called Roots. And Roots is an hour and a half together where we go over a little bit of the history of this tradition and this church and answer any question that you have. And if you would like to get to know us better, this week it's coming up. Information's in the order of service. It's a great opportunity to join. Two quick things. You'll find in your order of service there is a sheet asking for some of your feedback. We would like to know what worship times make for the most vibrant and meaningful encounter for you and your family. Ideally, a worship service is full enough to be really vibrant and also have room for the next family, the next person who comes into the church and joins us. And so we're seeking your feedback. We want to know, why do you come to church at the hour you do? The reasons behind it, what would your preferences be? It helps us to know how we structure church in the most meaningful and efficient ways to make sure that everybody has a seat at the table. It's nice to have a good full Sunday here today. And lastly, today, especially if you're new, I should point out that today is what's called Transition Sunday in our church. Like we talked about with the kids, we bless our coming of age youth as well as our youth who are graduating from the church or our youth program or high school here. We'll get to more of that in just a minute. The most important thing to say right now is welcome. We are glad that you're here. Whoever you are, whomever you love, and wherever you are on your spiritual path, we're glad that you found us this morning and that you helped us build church again. We take an offering every week, not only so we can sustain the life of this church, but also so that we can practice the art of being grateful, the art of recognizing that we are under sunny skies that we couldn't buy or build, that we take part in communities and families and friendships that we couldn't have by ourselves. So each week, we give thanks for life, for this place, and for the world we build with an offering. We say we have been greatly blessed. Let us give generously so that others might be blessed by the work of this church. The offering will be given and received.
Down and trouble, and you need some love and care, and nothing is going right. Close your eyes and think of me. And soon I will be there to brighten even your darkest night. You just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running. To spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there. Yes, I will. You've got a friend so cold. They'll hurt you, yes, and desert you, and take your soul if you let them. Oh, but don't you let them. You'll just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running, running, yeah, to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there, solid. You've got a friend. You've got a friend. You've got a friend. You've got a friend.
Special thank you this Sunday to Vaughn Faison for providing our worship music. Vaughn, we're glad you're here. In our congregation and in Unitarian Universalism, we affirm that there's always new wisdom, truth, and understanding of the holy coming into the world and in our awareness. One of those sources is the teenagers that you're about to be introduced to. Over the past year in our coming of age program, which is like a confirmation or a bar bat mitzvah in our tradition, our youth have studied the history of our congregation and our tradition. They've done spiritual disciplines. They've learned what it means to be a member and to serve. They've done theology and spiritual practice reflection. One of the key things they've done is each of them been given a text to reflect on. Maybe it was from the Bible or a quote from a minister or some about the stars. What they did was reflect on it and come back to us and say, this is where I see God. This is how I understand a meaningful and whole life after reflecting on this text. And last night they gathered in the sanctuary and from this pulpit offered up those reflections with competence and vigor, with vulnerability and courage. It's not an easy task. And so today, after all of that hard work, we celebrate them and we invite their families to come forward at this time and introduce them to the congregation. Let us know a little bit more about them.
I'm Scott Dalton. This is my wife, Holly. We present our daughter, Audrey Dalton, who brings the gifts of courage, patience, and diligence to the congregation.
I'm Robert Van Wasbergen, and this is my wife, Lauren.
This is our daughter, Heather, and she brings the gifts of intellect, creativity, and kindness to the congregation.
My name is Jean Ann Powers, and this is my husband, Daryl Brown.
And this is Andrew Thomas Brown, and he brings the congregation generous love, boundless energy, and curiosity.
Good morning. We are Bernadette and Larry Davis. We're presenting our daughter, Anne Marie Davis. She brings the following gifts to the congregation: the gift of her strong will. She brings the gift of insight and the gift of her creativity.
We are Jim and Kelly Pay, and we are presenting to you with great honor our son, Alex Pay.
Alex brings the gifts of friendship, of kindness, and of conviction to the congregation.
Hi, my name is Barbara Schultz. I'd like to present my son, Jordan Schultz, to the congregation. He brings the gifts of thoughtfulness, inquisitiveness, and calm.
Hi, I'm Erin Burdett, and this is my husband, Brad Burdett. This is our son, Jack Baylor Burdett, who brings the gifts of curiosity, creativity, and a mischievous wit.
Hi, my name is Kristen Carlish, and this is my husband, Stephen Carlish. We'd like to present our daughter, Isabella Sabine Carlish. She brings the gift of kindness, compassion, and creativity.
I'm Daniel Cantor. My wife, Marianne Gargor, we bring Nicholas Gargor Cantor.
Nico brings the gift of humor, awareness for the disparities of people around him, and deep love and loyalty for his friends and family.
Hi, my name is Karen Stanton, and this is my husband, Mike Stanton, and we'd like to present our daughter, Carter Elizabeth Stanton.
Carter brings the gifts of passion, leadership, and advocacy to the congregation.
I'd like to invite the congregation to rise and to join together in the responsive words of blessing found on the screens. You'll read the part that's in italics. Knowing that we cannot pinpoint the moment, day, or year when childhood is left behind to enter adolescence, today we recognize your arrival at the age of accountability. Like us, you are now responsible for your own decisions and actions. Knowing that you have studied the history of our faith and given careful consideration to your own spiritual development and relationship to the divine, and knowing that through study, growth, and change, we come of age again and again as we travel life's path. Today, we pledge to walk beside you, companions along the way. We offer our blessing on this day of days as together we celebrate your coming of age. Let's celebrate them with a round of applause. Remain standing, and let's join in singing a coming of age hymn. It's number 10 in your green hymnal supplement. Day by day, we will sing verses 1 and 4, and the words are up there. Please stay.
Thank you.
Just a few years farther down the path, the young people who stand before you in this moment are graduating either from high school, maybe looking for their first job outside of home, maybe leaving this church, seeking a new life in a different city. Whatever the next chapter of their life brings, it brings uncertainty and freedom, growth, a lot of change, some fear, and lots of excitement. Many of the youth who stand before you in this moment who are graduating have been in this congregation for many years. So today, before we bless them, we take a moment to see snapshots from their lives before us on the screens.
I'm 15 for a moment. Oh, I'm 15. Just dreaming, counting the ways to where you are. I'm 22 for a moment. He feels better than ever, and we're on fire, making our way back from Mars. 15, there's still time for you. Time to buy and time to lose. 15, there's never a wish better than this. When you only got 100 years to live. I'm 33 for a moment. Still that girl. But you see, I'm of age, a kid on the way, a family on my mind. I'm 45 for a moment. The sea is high and I'm heading into a crisis, chasing the years of my life. 15, there's still time for you. Time to buy and time to lose yourself within a morning star. 15, I'm all right with you. 15, there's never a wish better than this. When you only got 100 years to live, half time goes by, suddenly you're wise, the sun is getting high, 67 is gone, another blink of an eye, we're moving on. I'm 99 for a moment, dying for just another moment, and I'm just dreaming, counting the ways to where you are. 15, there's still time for you. 22, I feel her too. 33, you're on your way. Every day's a new day. Whoa, 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 whoa. Choose 15. There's never a wish better than this. When you only got 100 years to live.
everybody to rise again. The congregation, please rise, and let's join in some words of blessing and charge to these amazing youth. Their words will be found on the screens. Remember that we are your church home. Take this flame with hold dear. All the lessons we have learned together. May it light you on your path as you grow in mind, body, and spirit. Be bold, be brave, share generously in the lives of Unitarian Universalists you will meet, as you have been generous with us. Go forward with our blessings and love. Thank you. You can be seated.
I know the world is black and white. Try to keep an open mind, but I just can't sleep on this tonight. Stop this train, I wanna get off and go home again. I can't take the speed, it's moving in. I know I can't, honestly. Won't someone stop this train? So scared of getting older, I'm only good at being young. So I play the numbers game to say my life has just begun. Had a talk with my old man, said help me understand. He said turn 68, oh, you'll renegotiate. Stop this train. Don't for a minute change the place you're in. I never could really understand. I tried my hand, and honestly, we're never gonna stop this train. So now once in a while, when it's good, it'll feel like it should. And they're all still around, and you feel safe and sound. And you don't miss a thing till you cry. As you're driving away in the dark, saying stop this train, I wanna get off and go home again. I can't take the speed, it's moving in. I know I can, and honestly, we'll never stop this train. We're never gonna stop this train. We're never gonna stop this train. We're never gonna stop this train.
Let us continue in prayer. God of many names, and mystery beyond all our naming. We gather here for a moment of pause in a life and a world that often feel like a train moving full speed ahead. We rest here in the stillness to reflect on and give thanks for our place in life, knowing that it will continue to change day to day and year to year. We gather here in community praying that amidst all this change, that our minds be filled with wonder and wisdom, that our hearts be filled with love for this life, that the work of our hands be guided by purpose, and may the Holy be with us always, filling us with courage and compassion. Like the young people that we have blessed here today, as they come of age and bridge into young adulthood, may we be rooted always in our faith, knowing that a community is here to hold us, to encourage us, to call us in, and to reflect back to us who we are. We lift one another in prayer when we celebrate and when we struggle. And today there are many among us who have asked us to speak their names so that they might feel the love of this place. Our hearts are with Rosemary Payne and Jeannie Fritz, recovering from time in the hospital, with Heather Hoskinson as she cares for her father, Richard, with the Hoaglands as Maridel's sister-in-law, Joanne, nears the end of life, and with Lyle Shipton and Israel Lopez as they mourn the death of Lyle's uncle, Len. May they all know our love, feel our strength, and find healing. And many among us are marking important milestones in their lives and the lives of their loved ones. So that today we celebrate with John and Nancy Bryant, who are marking 30 years of marriage, with John Whaley as he receives his master's degree, and with Delene and Bill Maxwell, whose grandson Eric has graduated and been commissioned as a Marine. We hold all of these celebrations and all of these struggles, as well as the many prayers that remain in the silent sanctuaries of our hearts. We hold them now in a time of shared silence. All of this we pray in the names of those known and unknown, present and absent, remembered and forgotten. We pray in the names of all helpers of humankind. Amen.
Blessed are they who sit through two church services. It can sometimes be a blessing. A couple of years ago, some members of our congregation gave me a gift which is absolutely perfect for a Unitarian church history nerd, a niche audience, but a robust one if you find the right thing. And what this gift was a letter written by the minister, Reverend William Ellery Channing, to his daughter when she was a little girl. Aw, yeah, thank you, because that's how I felt. Written to his daughter when she was a little girl. Channing was one of the great progressive ministers of the early 19th century. He's the person who really helped shape and give form to Unitarianism in America as a thing, as a denomination. He preached about the goodness of the human soul. In a time when people were claiming that humans were depraved and evil just for being born, he said, no, there is something holy and decent. We're inherently good. He said that in us is a likeness to God. He said to his congregation that if you read the scriptures and your reason doesn't match, you should trust your reason and your intuition. That the presence of God also shows up in your mind. that a book can be a great source of wisdom, but that it's not always literally true. This letter came to his daughter, Mary, when she was spending time at their family farm. She's probably elementary school aged at this time. We're talking 1820s, maybe. She's just sent him a drawing in the mail and a letter that it seems like that she dictated to somebody by what he says. He says this to her. "My dear Mary, your letter gave me much pleasure. Can you find nobody to teach you how to write? I see a man shredding grass in the yard. Why does he do it? What did I tell you about the elephants yesterday? What will be our greatest pleasure when we reach the farm? You say that you wish to learn faster. Then you must attend more. What do I mean by attending? Have you borne any pain today without complaining? You must learn to suffer better. Your father, who always loves you." If that is not just the most 19th century thing to say to maybe an 8-year-old girl, you must learn to suffer better. But he repeats it once. What do I mean by attending? And in the note, he underlines that word. What do I mean by attending? You must learn to suffer better. My assumption is that that's not a message you hear often from a Unitarian pulpit or in a graduation speech at high school or on television. But I think there's something to it. Because as I look around at what the world so often promises in commercials or in some faith traditions, some of what I learned in school or I had in my first jobs, the notion was that success and growth meant that I could accumulate enough wealth, power, status, or goods that I may not have to feel the full reality of a human life. I could find a neighborhood that was safe enough that I wouldn't be scared. My kids would grow up in a school that was good enough to protect them from some of the troubles of the world. If things got too hard, I could drink or eat or smoke something that would make that feeling go away, if I could afford it. That the right clothes or the right car, the right job, a 401k plan, or even insurance or just temporary health would somehow protect me. And then I could really get to living. I could know where happiness and truth and success and God and deep relationship came in, just as long as I was protected from all the tough stuff. There's the notion that success comes from learning to externally control life until it's really domesticated and manageable and sanitized. Now me, I don't fall for the external control story as much. Where I get tripped up is believing the internal control myth. That's the one where I think that if I just get up at 5:30 every day and journal just the right amount in my journal and I meditate for just long enough and I have the right diet and the best emotional control techniques and I keep my routine for productivity going just along, I'll keep this all at bay and I'll be happy and nobody's gonna get hurt, especially me. That's a very compelling myth. And it's one I fall into all the time, but the trap is still the same. The idea is that I will know real life just as long as the barricades are up and everything's where it's supposed to be. Real life does not include things I can't control. How silly of me. The Franciscan priest and writer Richard Rohr, who I know many of you are familiar with, says that far from the things that we control, the two primary paths to a transformed life come in the form of great love and great suffering. He says that there's just something you don't know about life until you have known great love or great suffering. That it might not feel like good news, and you might take it back and wish it hadn't happened, but there's something about being human that you only learn in the presence of realities you cannot control. The realities that break apart any idea that you have control over the world, or that life is tidy and domesticated and manageable. When those dualities of right and wrong, us and them, me and the world break down through love or suffering, he says, then we start to see glimpses of the God, the Christ, the mystery, all the words that people use for this ineffable thing. I think the notion that great love and great suffering may be the path to transformation is good news, even if it doesn't always sound like it. How will you measure your growth in life? Bank account, job title, resume, physical health? We all make determinations on this all the time. And we have so many people and institutions trying to convince us that one measurement tool is right. I heard one recently from a religious leader that struck me, and I think he's right. His name is Jean Vanier. He recently died this past week. He was the leader of a community called L'Arche. It's French for the Ark. Jean Vanier is a French-Canadian philosopher, and he formed this community when he, in France, years ago, in the 1960s, saw how people with intellectual disabilities were treated. Because the community around them couldn't bear to witness a different kind of human life, they were shunned and put away in a place where they were isolated and kept almost in the dark for hours and hours every day. When Jean Vanier saw this as a young man, he invited two men living in that asylum to come and live with him, and that was the first L'Arche community. Today, it's a global network of houses and almost monasteries where people living with intellectual disabilities and people without intellectual disabilities live together. They pray, they have church, they work together. The idea being that nobody is there to fix or remove the parts that appear to the outside world as broken, but to bear witness to one another. He talks about a man named Adam who lived in one of the communities who couldn't speak. He said, for a person who couldn't speak, he had a tremendous impact on the room he was in. That he learned a great deal about tenderness and patience that he would have never known. And that there was a kind of love that he only knew in the midst of things and people that others had said were somehow broken. When he was asked near the end of his life how you measure your spiritual growth, he said this: you measure your growth in your capacity to be wounded. Which sounds really odd. Can you imagine someone asking, how are you doing? How's your life? I hear you're working on your job and your soul and yourself and your health. How are you? And you say, oh, it's going great. I'm growing in my capacity to be wounded. You'd get a look. Now, what he doesn't mean by that is staying in the midst of abuse or physical pain. What he doesn't mean is being a doormat, or worshiping suffering, or playing the victim, or the bad theology that says God sends suffering to be redemptive for people. That's not what he means. What he means when he says that your capacity to be wounded shows your growth is that your heart has grown big enough to encompass anything that comes its way. That all the many protective barriers that we put up over and over again have come down. And suddenly the fullness of life, great love, and great suffering come piercing through. If you practiced a heart that is that open, you will encounter great love and great suffering. You will have a capacity to be wounded, but only because you have a heart that is open to experiencing the holy all around you. What Jean Vanier said is that so often in our life, what we do is we recognize the parts of us that feel weak or broken or off, and we either try to ignore them or numb it or pretend it doesn't happen or build up a wall around it, and that might feel okay, but what it does is make us disgusted at other people's weakness or frailty. And so we isolate and we move away and we're not ever really in real relationship with somebody. And so our capacity to be wounded is our capacity to love. That sounds almost as odd to me as the advice, you must learn to suffer better. But think of almost any great mystic or teacher, poet, or saint or seeker that we draw from in this place. They've said something similar. Look at someone like the Buddha, who spent the first formative years of his life in a palace, guarded, given every pleasure he could possibly imagine. He was safe and secure and fat and happy. And yet he only found enlightenment by leaving the guarded walls of the palace and encountering things like sickness and old age and death. It was precisely through attending to those things, not running from those things, attending to those things, where he found peace and enlightenment and compassion. Think of the teacher Jesus, who seems to take the people and the realities that other people run kicking and screaming away from, and he says, I think that's where God is. We should go over there. In the poorest, sickest, most dispossessed people. In some traditional Christian theology, the idea is that God knows humanity through participating in humanity. For those of us in the room for whom his human life is more important, just imagine what it would look like to measure your success by your downward mobility, your presence with the poorest, sickest people you could find, and your capacity to know love and suffering in their fullness. No matter what the television, or your job, or your school, or your friends, or your family say, none of these wise mystics and poets have picked the protection plan for life. They have all said that our grace, our enlightenment, our peace, our wisdom, our love will come when we attend to the biggest realities in the world. If you will, bring to mind someone in your life who shows up for you no matter what. The person whose presence fills you with comfort, an ocean of grace. Who would you go and sit in a chair in their living room and say, I need help? Do you have somebody? My guess is that that person isn't someone who shies away from great love or great suffering. My guess is that person doesn't leave your gaze when you say the words, I love you. That they never said to you, oh, you're sick? Ooh. Or, that's just too sad. My guess is that the person to whom you would give your heart would sit with you in the midst of whatever was happening, unafraid to bear witness to it and show love. And I can look around the sanctuary, and because we're blessed with knowing so many people's stories, see person after person after person who has known both great love and great suffering in their life and used it to build something precious and good. This is not to say that those of you who have encountered tremendous suffering wouldn't take it back. I know you would. Wouldn't erase it, wouldn't use a time machine and cast it away and forget that it ever happened. But I've watched you attend to it. Not run away from those feelings, but attend to them and turn them into compassion and love and generosity and service for other people like magic. A graduation address or a commercial might promise that the next product you buy, the next supplement you take, the right diet, the right gym, the right degree program, or the neighborhood will finally be the thing that protects you enough to be happy. It might finally be the thing that relaxes you enough to encounter God or love. Don't buy the protection plan. No matter if you're 15 or 95, that's not where real life is. What we can promise you in this place is that life will include great love and great suffering in abundance. The skies will sometimes be bright and shining with stars, and you'll hold a newborn child in your arms and wonder at creation. You'll look into the eyes of someone who says, I love you and means it. The world will be filled with joy and poetry and song. And there will be storms and terrible monsters on the path. All of it together. But if you choose the path of numbing yourself or protecting yourself or walling yourself off, you will miss everything. So maybe we might learn to suffer better, or at least attend to it. To pay attention to our capacity to be wounded and ask yourself, is my heart growing big enough to take whatever life throws at it? Surround yourself with people who are willing to be with you in the midst of great love and great suffering, who do not shy away and who practice an open heart. Spoiler alert, that's a church. Pay attention to the moments when your heart is growing enough to be wounded. Don't shy away or lose the next person's gaze who stares you in the eyes and says, I love you. The practice of an open heart will teach you things about living well and God and human life that you can learn nowhere else. May your heart be full. May you sometimes suffer well. And may you know great love. Amen. I'll invite you to sing together with us. The final hymn today is number 115, God of Grace and God of Glory. We'll sing the first verse and the last verse. This week and all weeks, may you meet the holy in unexpected places. May you give love and receive it freely. And may you have the courage it will take to give your life the miracle it is as a blessing to all the world. Go in peace. Amen.
Just want you to all know that you can sing along if you feel like it. My eyes, then something without wanting love bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be
a lovely day. Yeah, yeah, yeah. A lovely day. When the day that lies ahead of me seems impossible to face, when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, the way, the way, then I look at you and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Lovely day. You sound great. Lovely day.